You're probably familiar with G from Newton's law of gravitation. The force between two objects is equal to the product of their masses divided by the distance between them squared, and last, but most certainly not least, multiplied by 0.00000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000 was introduced into physics to calculate the gravitational attraction, back in 1687. But G serves a very specific purpose in the law of universal gravitation. It's not just a number, it also has units. You see, F is measured in newtons, but the right-hand side is measured in kilograms squared over meter squared, and these two units are not equivalent to each other. So you need something to make them equivalent, and that's G. G is measured in meter squared over kilogram squared times newtons. So this way, both the right and the left-hand side are measured in newtons. But G is also used in the modern version of gravity. In 1915, Einstein proposed his general theory of relativity. And general relativity completely replaces the law of universal gravitation. But there's one feature of the law that does make it in GR, and that's G. As you can see, G is present in Einstein's equations. G was also used by Max Planck in 1899 in his definition of the Planck length. The Planck length is supposed to be the shortest length possible, according to modern physics. Physics doesn't make sense when distances get smaller than that, and you need G to calculate it. And as a product of the Planck length, we get the Planck time, which is the time it takes light to travel that distance, and consequently, Planck time is the smallest time possible. Physics doesn't make sense when time gets shorter than that, and you need G to calculate it. So, how do we know G's value? It seems like it's a significant number. Previously, I said that G's value is 6.7408 times 10 to the minus 11. But the truth is, that's the average of the upper and lower limit. We don't actually know G's value with full precision. It's somewhere between 6.67377 times 10 to the minus 11 and 6.67439 times 10 to the minus 11. That means it has an uncertainty of 0.00031 times 10 to the minus 11, which is terrible. That's too big of an uncertainty for a number like G. In fact, in the quadata list of physics constants, G has the highest relative uncertainty of all. But there are two good reasons behind it. First, since every object is gravitationally attracted to every other, you can never completely isolate an experimental apparatus from the gravitational influence of other bodies. And second, gravity has no established relation to the other three fundamental forces: electromagnetism, strong nuclear force, and the weak nuclear force. General relativity, which describes gravity, isn't compatible with quantum mechanics, which describes the other three forces. So it isn't possible to calculate it indirectly either. In some other areas of physics, constants are derived from other constants that can be measured more accurately, but that's not the case with G. The classic experiment, which gave a significant insight to G's value, goes back to 1798, and it was performed by Henry Cavendish, and concluded that G is equal to 6.754 times 10 to the minus 11, which is just 1% off the currently accepted value. 1%! That's the progress we managed to do after 200 years. And I saved the best for last. G is classified as a fundamental constant. This is the scientific way of saying we don't have an explanation to why g has the value it has. We found it experimentally, but we can't give any reason why it has that value and not any other value in the real number line. That's what we call a fundamental constant. G is not derived from anything else. We use g to draw conclusions. Like the example I gave earlier with the Planck length and Planck time. Both of them are derived from g. So, why is this the smallest distance possible? Partly because this value is this. Why is this the shortest time possible? Partly because this value is this. Why is gravity so weak? Partly because this value is this. Why is this value this? We don't know.